Good morning.
Good morning.
And this is Christmas morning, and we're celebrating our Savior's birth. And for those online, we do a special Christmas service where most of the liturgy is sung to Christmas tunes. And you may have received that if you get our bulletins by email. Otherwise, follow along as best you can. And the theme for the day is The Touch of Christmas. We are finishing up the five-part series on the senses or sensations of Christmas. We have had the sounds of Christmas, the sights of Christmas, the weariness of Christmas. Last night was the fragrance of Christmas. And this morning, then, we finish up with the touch of Christmas. Let us begin with our first hymn, which is the first two verses of Now Sing We Now Rejoice, hymn 386. Rise and begin with the words of our baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God, our merciful Father. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we admit and confess our sinfulness. We have turned away from each other in our thinking, speaking, and doing. We have done the evil you forbid and have not done the good you demand. We do repent and are truly sorry for these our sins. Have mercy on us, kind Father, because of the obedience of our brother, Jesus Christ, your Son. Forgive us all that is past, and with the power of the Holy Spirit, move us to serve you faithfully. Set our feet upon the new path of life, and build your kingdom here, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, by his authority and by his command, I therefore forgive you all your sins, In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
And we sing. Let us pray. Almighty God, grant that the birth of your only begotten Son in human flesh may set us free from the bondage of sin. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. The Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Isaiah, Chapter 49. Listen to me, O coastlands, and give attention, you peoples from afar. The Lord called me from the womb, from the body of my mother. He named my name. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified." But I said, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my right is with the Lord, and my recompense is with my God." And now the Lord says, "He who formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring back Jacob to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has become my strength." He says, "It is too light a thing that you should be my servant, to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to bring back the preserved of Israel. I will make you as a light for the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Jesus boy, they made you be born in a manger. Sweet little holy child, they didn't know who you was. Didn't know you come to save us, Lord, to take our sins away. Our eyes was blind. Just seems like we can't do right. Look how we've treated you.
Our epistle lesson is taken from the first letter of John, chapter 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We sing the last two verses of O Little Town of Bethlehem.
How silently, how silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of
rise to hear the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Verse 9. The true light which enlightens everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me.' And from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the only begotten God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. We sing our sermon hymn, number 369, "Where Shepherds Lately Knelt." Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The verses that we begin the sermon with are Luke 2, verse 7. "And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." John 1, verse 14 and verse 18. "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. No one has ever seen God. The only begotten God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 1, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. So the touch of Christmas. The Bible takes us in a completely different direction from all other religions, beliefs, philosophies, ways of thinking. Everything else says about God, let your mind ascend into heaven, where you will find God far removed from the world and all the things in the world. And then they talk about possible visions and meditation and learning to be far from this world and seeking to find God. And Christianity is absolutely different. This is about the coming of God into the world in a manger with tiny little hands and feet, a baby who happens to be the coming of God into our entire life. It is God in the flesh, so that we would never again ever have to search and guess and wonder if there is actually a loving God. Because if he is born to be one of us, if he has decided to be one of the human race, no matter what the consequences, if he has decided to call us his friends and family, no matter what the cost, then there is no more need to search and wonder if we can figure out life and truth and what we are worth and what we are destined for. It is all wrapped up there in the person of Jesus. That's why Christians come to this day. And it is why Christmas seems to interrupt the world and the human race, to interrupt us in our headlong rush to we don't know quite where. The touch of Christmas. After all the prophecies and the visions of God in the Old Testament, after the weary journeying from Bethlehem to, from Nazareth to Bethlehem, from the Garden of Eden to the manger, after the deep sense inside, this here is the real thing. And it's the Apostle John who brings it into focus most sharply. John, who spent a lot of time with Mary in their later years. John, who cared for her as part of his household. And so they had plenty of time to look back and think and remember and reflect. So Mary, thinking about holding the little baby Jesus. And this is God in her arms. John thinking about walking with Jesus, hearing him teach, watching the miracles, thinking about celebrating the Lord's Supper, and then seeing Jesus arrested, crucified, laid in the tomb, and then risen from the dead. I said this in the spring, Christianity is the warm body religion. And John says, what we have heard, what we have looked at and touched with our hands. This is one of the most wonderful parts of Christianity. God did not stay up in heaven. He did not send a text. And Christianity is not a set of propositions and theories. Christianity is a warm body religion. Jesus came into our world to become one of us so that we could touch him. He was there in the manger, and Mary could hold and carry God. The shepherds could come and see the Lamb of God and let his little hand wrap around their finger. The wise men could bring their gifts and marvel that God had come into the world and come into the world in this way. And then bow and worship God who came to earth to be touched and held. This is our warm body God. This is the touch of Christmas. Jesus would grow up and would touch the sick, healing them. Touch the leper to cleanse him. Put his fingers in the ears of the deaf man. And then look up to heaven and sigh together with him. He would put mud on the eyes of the man born blind and give him sight. He would take the hand of Jairus' daughter and bring her back to life. And touch and heal the ear cut off of the servant of the high priest there in Gethsemane. This is our warm body Savior, God with us, Emmanuel. And Jesus would receive the kiss from Judas, the slap during the trial, the scourging under Pilate, the crown of thorns, and the nails from the soldiers, the burial from Joseph and Nicodemus, and then be held on to by Mary Magdalene on Easter morning, and invite Thomas to put your finger here in the mark of the nail. And see, he is the living God. He is our Redeemer, and this is why we say in the Catechism, he has redeemed me not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood and with his innocent suffering and death. Very personal, very physical. And it goes on, that I may be his own and live under him in his kingdom. Again, very personal. And serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he is risen from the dead, lives and reigns to all eternity. He lives, and we will live. This is why this is not just some old story. The Jesus of Bethlehem, of Nazareth, of Jerusalem, of the trial and cross and empty tomb is the same Jesus today. And it is not only those people way back 2,000 years ago who knew the touch of Christmas. Jesus calls us. He invites us here to come to his supper today. And then he takes his body and he puts it on our tongue. He takes his blood and pours forgiveness out on our lips. It is the warm body God. And we experience Christmas and Easter in the presence of Jesus also with the sense of touch. This is our God, Emmanuel, one of us and God with us. Because he is the warm body God, we expect one day to see him with these eyes and reach out and touch him with these hands. Join John in saying, what we have heard, what we have looked at, and our hands have handled. You could say it is an in-your-face coming of God into the world. And so God confronts. But how he confronts is by bringing us face to face with life and salvation. Jesus draws us into his fellowship. And John wants to draw the readers and hearers in too, because that fellowship is the fellowship in life and the fellowship of the gospel, destined to include people from every tribe and people and nation and language, being joined with Jesus by faith so that what is his becomes ours. The Christmas story is actually a mirror image of our future. Jesus is born to come into our world, to be one of us, to be with us, to be like us, to be touched by the people of this world. We are waiting for the time when he will bring us into his eternity to be with him, to be made like him in his image, and to touch and see not only with the eyes, but see with the hands. It's a back and forth, Jesus coming to us to bring us with him, coming in weakness in order to raise us by his strength and give us the strength of the Word of God and the strength of faith. Comes to bear our sin so that we can share his holiness. Comes into our flesh, that touchable flesh, in order to take that flesh and transform it and glorify it so that we can reach out and touch God. Comes into our separation to bring us into the perfect harmony and the closeness with God. We celebrate Christmas, looking back and remembering that God came very physically into our world. And we celebrate Christmas, looking forward. One day we will see him, one day stand before him, one day be celebrating with him, and he celebrating with us, rejoicing together and the blessing of eternity. Merry Christmas. In Jesus' name, amen. We rise. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the true faith in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. We sing the first verse of He's Your Emmanuel. We join in confessing our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated as we go to our Lord in prayer. Our Lord and Savior Jesus, we come to you with praise because you have come to us in order to share this human nature, the weakness of this flesh, and to carry us by your strength through death and into life. We ask you to be with those who have lost loved ones this Christmas season. Especially today we pray for the family of Jim Zakovec, who passed from this life yesterday evening. We pray for the family of Linda Bachman, of Steve Nestfeld, of Evelyn Swenhagen, of Louise Nelson. We ask you, Lord Jesus, be their comfort as you came to share this mortal life. We thank you that you have brought them to share in the eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask for the many who call out to you with various illnesses. We ask for the multitude around the world who are suffering from the pandemic. We ask you, dear Lord, guide our doctors and nurses, give them strength. Guide our scientists, give them the ability to find cures, vaccines, and treatments. Lift up your people so that we may boldly comfort our neighbors, encourage those who are discouraged from the long time of suffering under this disease. Guide the leaders of our nation and the nations of the world, that your people may be blessed, and also that we may freely share the gospel of life and salvation in you, Lord Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us, Father, for we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Emmanuel, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
So we begin our service of communion.
church on earth and the host of heaven above. Let us praise his name whose birth brings us lost eternal love. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have given us a new revelation of your glory, that seeing you in the person of your Son, we may know and love those things which are not seen. Therefore, with angels, archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, join in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Our first four families, family units, to come forward. That would be all of this side. Welcome to the table of the Lord. Take and eat the true body of Christ given for you. Take and eat the true body of Christ given for you. Take and eat the true body of Christ. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sin. Take and drink. This is the true blood of Christ shed for you. And now may Christ's body and blood strengthen and keep you in the true faith to life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. And our second table, our other four families. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. And we sing.
Oh,
Let us pray. O God the Father, fount and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in the sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Well, we sing one of the versions of Away in a Manger today, and we will sing the other version on Sunday. So, Away in a Manger, the cradle song today. So we come to the end of our service, and there are some very important announcements in my mind. Merry Christmas to all, and to those watching with us through live streaming. Now, tomorrow and Sunday comes the end of a 20-year-long project, and that was my project to preach on every book of the Bible. The last two happened to be 2 John and 3 John, those tiny little letters toward the end of the New Testament. And Sunday happens to be the day of John, apostle and evangelist. And so tomorrow evening will be 2 John. Early service on Sunday will be 3 John. And then the late service on Sunday will again be 2 John. And I invite all of you and those by live streaming. The live streaming will be there, and the other will be posted on our website. Okay, are there other announcements? Think. Yes. When the year changes over to 2021, boy, will it be a relief. We hope. When the year changes over, our Sunday services will consolidate. We will have one Sunday service at 9:30. And if you think it's going to be a little bit too crowded, I'm going to ask the camera operator, swing it around and show our new overflow section there in the tiled area. That's our Bible study area, but now it's our worship overflow section, and there's a speaker back there, and so you can maintain a whole lot of social distancing and still come to church. And this is special because it is important to have the gathering together. It is important also because we have the body and blood of Jesus offered in our services. And so, to everyone, may you have the peace of Christmas. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill to men. We bid you peace.